Happy Sabbath, everyone. We want to welcome you to today's Sabbath. We invite you in a special way to the music session today. My name is Stella Agabas.
And my name is Ruth. Welcome to today's Sabbath.
Welcome. Our next hymn is number 82, Before Jehovah's Awful Throne. Welcome.
Before Jehovah's awful throne, ye nations bow with sacred joy. Know that the Lord is God alone. He can create and he destroy. Sovereign power without aid, made us of clay and formed us men, and when like wandering sheep we strayed, he brought us to his fold.
Happy Sabbath. Today, we want to welcome you to our worship. It's a blessed Sabbath morning, and we want to join together to praise God. Today is our BM Personal Ministry Sabbath, and today we have so many programs lined up for you. We have the children program, we have the lesson discussion from the children, we have the adult lesson, and we have the Bible study in the afternoon. But don't forget that we have the main sermon at the peak of the hour by our speaker, who is drawn from our church. So let us pray to start off our Sabbath this morning. Our gracious and loving Father and God in heaven, a very special Sabbath morning. Lord, Father, you have given a chance to be here to listen to your word. Father, how I pray that you may be able to give us a softening heart and a healing, that we may be able to receive the word of prayer for us this morning. This Sabbath day, Father, wherever we are, from our homes, from our places of viewing, Father, may you interact to each one of us. Take the word to every homestead, to every listening here, and even viewing eyes, O Jehovah. That in whatever you plan for us this day, may your will be done in our lives, O Jehovah. We know we are flowing in a very difficult times. Father, we know this big plan is here for us. In our own churches, Father, let us be strong and praise your name and lift you up, that you may be able to dismantle the power of the devil who is bringing about circumvention in our lives, O Jehovah. This morning I pray that, O Father, you may speak to each one of us as members of this family and those who are over and wide. And, O Father, may you speak to the speaker, use him mightily as he speaks to us this morning. The word he has prepared, you have given him, use him as a mouthpiece, Father, that you may be able to deliver the word, that in every way it might build us up and become good children before your presence as we prepare for your second coming. Take over every part of this program from now until the end of it, for it's a very humble prayer, and in Jesus Christ I pray and believe. Amen.
Song number 83. O worship the King, all glories above.
Oh, worship the King, all glorious.
Happy Sabbath, children.
Happy day.
Happy Sabbath, mummies and daddies at home.
Happy day.
I hope you had a good week. Yes. I'm so grateful for this morning that God has preserved us and we are all safe. Beginner class and kindergarten, we are learning about David. David the Good Shepherd. But before that, may we humble for a word of prayer. We are praying. Our gracious Master, thank you for this morning. Thank you for being together with us. Thank you for your protection, Lord. As you are going to read this lesson this morning, may you be together with us. This is our prayer in the mighty name of Jesus. We pray, trusting and believing. Amen. Amen. So the topic of our lesson is David the Good Shepherd. Please repeat with me.
David the Good Shepherd.
Again.
David the Good Shepherd.
And the memory verse comes from the book of Colossians chapter 3 verse 10. Please repeat with me. Colossians chapter 3 verse 10. And it says, children, obey your parent in everything. Repeat, please. Children, obey your parent in everything. And the message is, I am part of a family. Please repeat with me.
I am part of a family.
Family is made up of daddy, mommy, brother or sister. And also auntie is part of family, yes? We are all part of family. And David too was part of a family and a big family. He lived with his daddy, mommy, and brothers. He loved helping his parent. Children, do we love helping our parent at home?
Yes.
Do we?
Yes.
By doing what?
Sweeping the house.
Cleaning the utensils. Someone else. Wiping the table. All those. Help our parent. David too was helping his parent by looking after the sheep. Sometimes he could go and take a lamb, this is a sheep, take a lamb and start petting it like so. He would pet it quietly. By doing so, he was showing love to the lamb. He was showing love to the little lamb. So he was loving and he was caring. Imagine the sheep knew Moses' voice. He was such a good shepherd. He was such a good shepherd. They knew David's voice. And whenever he called them, they would come running. Do we run when our mommy calls us?
Yes.
Do we run when our daddy calls us?
Yes.
Yes, because we are good children, we run. David knew when it was time for the sheep to take water. He would lead them quietly to the pool to take some water. Do we take water when you are thirsty?
Yes.
Do we?
Yes.
Yes, we do take water. Water is good for our body. And again, David would look for a good and green field, good and green grass for the sheep to eat. And the sheep would enjoy eating it. Yummy, yummy, yummy. Do we enjoy eating something good that mommy has prepared for us?
Yes.
Do we? Yes. And while David, he's still watching the sheep, enjoying the grass, David was a talented musician. He was a talented musician. He had such a beautiful voice. He could sing beautifully to God, praising God. And he had a harp. Do we know a harp?
Yes.
Have you ever seen a harp?
Yes.
It's a music instrument like this one. He would sit quietly and start singing with that harp. I can imagine he was singing a song. I can imagine he was just singing a song praising God and saying, God, you're the one who created the weather. You're the one who has created the rain, the sun, and now the rain has rained, and my sheep has something to eat and drink. Do you know that song that says, God made the sun? Can you sing along? One, two, go. God made the sun shine. God made the rain. God made the wind that blows. Every kind of weather is enough for me. Yo, 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 yo. Oh, yo, 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 yo. Oh. And so the sheep enjoyed listening to David's music. He was singing beautifully to God. One day, while he was still grazing, he heard a voice. He heard a voice, and that voice, it was familiar. And it was a terrifying voice. It was not a very good voice. Something was roaring. And boom, there goes a lion. A lion, yes. The king of the jungle. Have you ever seen a lion?
Yes.
Have we?
Yes.
Yes, that one. It was looking at the sheep. It wanted to eat sheep. It was so hungry. And it was really wanted to eat the sheep. And now, remember we said the sheep knew Moses' voice. David's voice. The sheep knew David's voice. And so David stood and called, sheep, watch out. The lion is after you. What do you think the sheep did? They ran. And Moses went and he chased the lion. And he saved all the sheep. And the sheep was safe. And again, as David was seated, he heard again another voice. Again, it was a roar. He heard that voice. He heard it again. He heard it again. And boom! It was a bear. Shh, this one looks like a panda, but for today it will be a bear. Boom, and there goes the bear. Again, he stood and called the sheep. Watch out, the bear is after you. And he went and killed that bear. And he saved the sheep, and all the sheep were safe. When it was time to go home in the evening, he led the sheep quietly and quietly home. All the sheep were safe. Listen, what do we learn from this story? Children, what do we learn from this story? Yes?
That we should be caring like David.
Like we should be caring like David. What else do we learn from the story?
We should be loving.
We should be loving. What else do we learn from the story? We should take care of our pet. Do we have pets at home?
Yes.
Like? Dog.
Cat.
Yes, all those are pets. We should take care of our pets at home, yes? And God will be happy and he will bless us, okay?
Happy Sabbath.
Happy day.
Welcome to our class, our ringtime class today. And we are going to look at our lesson for today. But before that, let's humble ourselves for a word of prayer. Gracious Father, we come before you this morning with thanksgiving in our hearts. Lord, we thank you for taking us through the week that has passed. And now, Father, as we are going to look at our lesson for today, we invite your presence to be with us. And when we come to the end of it, Father, we shall remember to glorify your name, because we have prayed, trusting, and believing in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Now, our lesson for today is about mission to the world. And we have a story entitled Into All the World. But before we look at the story, I want us to go back to last week's lesson where we were talking about bearing the title Christian. And our story was about wearing the label. The label here, we are talking about a brand. You've heard of these interesting brands, you know, as real timers, we are in our teenage, we look at a shirt that is written Arsenal, Calvin Klein, those are the brands we go for. So you remember the story of the girl who went out and she bought a branded shirt for the sister, and when she brought it home, the sister was so excited, but after one wash, the label, it ran off and she was so discouraged. She realized it was just an imitation with the correct brand. So here we were talking about, we saw that the label that really matters though is the one we wear ourselves on the one hand. Jesus doesn't want us getting up, being tied up in knots with guilt of whether we are good enough to wear the name, to wear his name. He loved us and died for us on the cross. That is what saves us. Nothing we can do for ourselves. Once we wear that name, we need to take it seriously. When the world looks at us, they may judge what a Christian is by what they see us doing. So back to our lesson for today, we are talking about mission to the world. And our memory text comes from the book of Revelation, chapter 14, verse 6. It says, "Then I saw another angel flying in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting message to preach to those who dwell on the earth, to every nation, tribe, tongue, and people." Now, this one is linked up to our beliefs, number 13, the remnant and its mission, which says, "The universal church is composed of all who truly believe in Christ, but in the last days, a time of widespread apostasy and remnant has been called out to keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Every believer is called to have a personal part in this worldwide witness." Now we go back to our story, the story of Into All the World. The Wycliffe Bible translators have been translating the Bible into different languages for a long time. And one time they wanted to go to Central America and they desperately wanted to translate the Bible to the local Indian languages. So one gentleman by the name Townsend, in 1935, together with his wife Elvira, they traveled to a village and they wanted to translate the Bible. While they were there, Townsend worked diligently to improve the quality of the life of the people in that village, while celebrating the unique qualities of their church. Now, the area around there was a fresh water spring, and the water was going to waste. Townsend just sat down and thought of what he could do to help the villagers. He just told them to divert the water from the spring and to make good use of it, to grow plants, to grow crops along the path of the river, the spring. The economy in the area blossomed, and Townsend wrote an article about the whole experience. It was so exciting. Remember, Townsend was a missionary. Then, the article that he wrote found its way to the desk of the president of Mexico, who was called Lázaro Cárdenas, who was curious about this gringo. Gringo was the name given to a foreigner who would come and live amongst people. Remember, as a missionary, he had left his comfort zone and he was in a foreign place. He didn't know their language, but he was out to pass the message about and spread the word about his church. So this is a part of the country where he went. It is a part that even the government employees rejected. They refused to work whenever they were transferred there. They would rather resign and go home. So, in the center of that village, the humble missionary made his way over to meet a visitor who had just arrived at the camp. And when he got there, he was like, "Who is this? You know that is a president, and usually the president moves around with a big team. Am I right?"
Yes.
So, when he saw the car, he walked there slowly, humbly, because he was a missionary. When he got there, the president told him, "You are the man I have come to see. Tell me about what you are doing here." Now, Lazarus Kadina was the president. This, the missionary Townsend, just shared the story about what he was doing. He said he was a missionary and he desired to even translate the Bible to the local language. He told him about, he asked him about what he had done, and he explained to him about the, how he thought of the locals using the springs of water to improve their livelihood. So the president allowed him to translate the Bible into the local language. What do you say?
Amen.
Now, during the season of favor, the gospel spread throughout the region and the word of God flourished among many different cultures. Now, mission work is all about sharing the gospel, but in many scenarios, the walls have to be broken down by selfless service and hard work. This is how the Savior worked on behalf of people. Now, can you think of some examples in the life of Christ? Any example you can think in the life of Christ? Okay, class, we shall just continue and think about that question as we go on. Now, there is a text I want us to read from the book of Matthew chapter 9 verse 35 to 38. We learn about a very sensitive topic. It is a moving scene of scriptures that we find here. Then Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the gospel of the kingdom and healing every sickness and every disease among the people. But when he saw the multitudes, he was moved with compassion for them, because they were weary and scattered like sheep, having no shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest truly is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." Now, here we are seeing that Jesus Christ started the missionary work. What we need here? Compassion moves people to action. From a distance, you can pity someone who is hurting. You can even sympathize and hurt for people who are suffering, because you know what they are going through is horrible. But you can still stay home and do nothing. So, we were commissioned to go and tell the good news about Jesus Christ to others. Compassion, as seen in the life of Jesus, forces people to act. Jesus shouts, "I need workers to help." Most people stop short of responding because they do not know what to do and where to go. What are we supposed to do? Start with your money. People who give to missions are more likely to live with the spirit of mission. Another paraphrase might be, put your money where your heart is. Where you want your heart to be is where you should put your money. So you can start with your money. Carve out time to pray and write letters to missionaries. Yes, we are young, we are 13, we are 14, we are 15, some of us are 16, and we may feel we are too young to do anything for missionary work. If we cannot go out there and speak to people, we can pray. Pray for the missionaries who are out there doing the work of God. Now, we can also sponsor a student missionary with letters of encouragement from home. We write to them where they are out there in mission. We tell them what is going on at home. We can tell them about the development around home so that they feel part of the community, so that they don't feel lonely and wish to come back home. Now, we can also send Bibles to children and people in areas which have not been reached by Christianity. Now, these are just a few ideas. The important thing is to do something. And it seems that the more you do, the more you will know what to do. It is not entirely clear why this is true, but it works. Try it. You start small and you grow. You will end up being missionaries. You don't have to be popular to be one. Now, he who gives money or time for spreading the gospel, and lists his own interests and prayers for the work and for the souls to be reached through his affections. Go out to others, and he is stimulated to greater devotion to God, that he may be enabled to do them the greatest good. This is quoted from Thoughts from the Mount of Blessings by Ellen G. White, page 90. Now, when we look, check through our Bibles in Matthew 28, verse 19. All right. Thank you. All right. Someone to read Matthew 28, verse 19. It says, you're not ready. It says, go into all the world and preach the gospel. It's known as the Great Commission. So our summary today, because of time, I'm rushing through, is talking about missionary work, which is traveling, leaving our comfort zones to take out the gospel. Now, there's a group of high school seniors who wanted to raise money for a class in an orphanage in Zambia. They raised about $3,000. The whole school heard about it, and everybody gave up their goodies, their fast food snacks and all that, and their fun, their clothes. They raised $72,000 for the school. What do you say?
Amen.
So, we can also do it. Mission work is for every citizen. Everyone who is called a Christian is set for mission work. And may God bless you as we prepare for next Sabbath lesson, which is entitled The Body of Believers and Mission. Our story will be world changers. Let us get ready for that. Shall we pray? Everlasting Father, we want to thank you for having taken us through the lesson. And as we go out for the new week, we pray that you walk with us. And when we meet again, Father, we shall give glory to your name because you have prayed in this aspect today.
Amen. Happy Sabbath. Happy day.
Happy Sabbath.
Thank you very much. Welcome, Primary. This is another new week, and we thank God we have an opportunity to worship at Sabbath. Now today, before we start, let us pray. Father, we thank you for this day. As we are going to look at our lesson, may you be with us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Welcome everybody. Primaries back at home, welcome. Now today, we are going to learn about very interesting topic. It says, the day Jesus cried. Can we say it again? The day Jesus cried. Can you imagine Jesus crying? Imagine Jesus, our Savior, is crying. What made Jesus cry? We look at that in our lesson. Now, today's verse, memory verse, it comes from the book of Galatians, chapter 6, verse 2. Can you open there? Children at home, open Galatians chapter 6, verse 2. We are getting our verse from the first part, which says, carry each other's burdens. It says what? Carry each other's burdens. Very good. And what about our message? Our message says, God wants me carry, to care for each other. Can we say that? God wants me to care for each other. Very good. Now, let's go to our story. It's a story about Jesus. Jesus had some three friends. One of them was called Lazarus. Can anybody tell me who the rest were? Lazarus. What was her sister's? Yes. Yes, Mary, and who else? Martha. Now, the story is about Jesus, Martha, and Mary. Now, these three friends, Lazarus, Mary, and Martha, were friends of Jesus. They lived in a small city called Bethany. When Jesus was walking and when he was around Bethany, he could always go and spend time with them and be with them. He could spend the night there and he could enjoy with them. Now one day, Jesus was in a faraway place with his disciples. He was teaching and healing like usual, like Jesus did. But a messenger came running to him, saying, "Hey, Jesus, you are needed somewhere. Your friend Lazarus is very ill. Martha and Mary have sent for you." Wow. Jesus did not even get, he did not worry about that, because he might have known Lazarus was ill. Now, what he told the messenger, he just said, "God's glory will be shown in that." And then he continued with his business. So he went on. Imagine he went on for 2 more days. And imagine his friend was sick. Back home, back in Bethany, Lazarus was very ill. And his health was deteriorating as days went by. Martha and Mary were beside him. They were really waiting for Jesus. Wow, days went by, and then Lazarus died. Now Martha and Mary were so down, they were so sad that their friend could not come. And they knew if Jesus was there, Lazarus could not die. They knew that very well. So Jesus went on with what he was doing. And back in Bethany, preparations were made and Lazarus was buried. Now, Jesus started coming 2 days after. So he started on his way down to Bethany. So as he was going, he was nearing there. The messenger was somewhere there and he saw him. Then he ran back to Martha and Mary and he said, "Jesus is on his way." Martha stood up and ran to Jesus. And when he reached at Jesus, he told Jesus, "Jesus, it is now 4 days, and where were you? Your friend has died. If you were there, he could not have died." Jesus knew he could raise Lazarus, and he had that plan, and he knew he could do that so that God's glory will be shown in that incident. So he consoled Martha, and Martha went back to tell her sister Mary that Jesus is coming. Our friend is coming. So Mary also got up and went. He ran to Jesus and he fell on his knees and he said, "Jesus, if you were there, my brother could not have died. It is now 4 days late." So, at that point, Jesus, Martha, and Mary, they were so sorrowful. Jesus shared in the sorrow. And that is the time that Jesus cried. Jesus cried to share his sorrows with Martha and Mary about their friend and brother Lazarus. So they went down to Bethany, they went home, and Jesus went straight to the tomb site where Lazarus was laid. And when he reached there, he called, "Lazarus, come out." Wow, Lazarus came out, and they were so happy. Jesus also shared in their happiness. Now, what does this story teach us? It teaches us that we should share. Remember our memory verse? Carry each other's burdens. And the message says, God wants me to care for others. Are we together? So Jesus really cared for his friends. But Jesus cried to share his sorrows with his friends. Again, why did Jesus cry? Jesus also cried because of the people who were there. He knew that they did not believe that he was Jesus and he could save them. They did not trust him. Jesus wants us to trust him and believe him. So, Jesus can also be so sad when you and me don't trust in him, and when you and me don't believe him. So today we learned that Jesus wants us to care for each other, and Jesus wants me and you to carry each other's burdens. Now you at home, I want you and mommy and daddy and uncle and your sister to help me sing this song. There's that song that says about burdens. We are happy to share, happy to bear one another's burdens. That way we are here. Thank you. Now we should sing that song, and we should take that lesson in our minds that we should share each other's burdens. May God bless you. Until next time. Bye-bye. Thank you.
O worship the King, O glorious above, O gratefully sing His wonderful love. Our shield and defender, the Ancient of Days, pavilion is splendor, and guarded with praise. O tell of His might, O sing of His praise, whose God is the light, whose God up is praise. His chariot abroad, the deep and the clouds fall, and dark is His path on the wings of the storm. The bountiful care, what tongue can recite? It breathes in the air, it shines in the light, it streams from the hills, it descends to the plain, and sweetly distills in the dew and the rain. Frail children of dust and faithless frail, in thee do we trust. Thy mercies, how tender, how fond to the end. Our Maker, Defender, Redeemer, and Friend.
Brothers and sisters, from wherever you are watching, welcome to our series of study, the lesson discussion from Northview SDA Church. Being the fourth lesson that we are doing since we started our online series, I want to welcome a panel that will be discussing together with me. From my far left,
I'm Elder Robert. Karibu sana. You're most welcome to this discussion.
Elder Robert, karibu. My brother.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Hezron Mui.
Hezron, karibu sana. And the only lady for today's discussion.
Happy Sabbath, viewers. My name is Glenna. Welcome.
Welcome, Glenna. My name is Robin. I'll be coordinating today's discussion. Before we go far, I want to welcome our elder, Elder Robert, to give an opening prayer for the discussion.
Our Lady Sambo, loving Father and God in heaven, we thank you this morning. As we start our lesson discussion, we invite our presence, may the Holy Spirit be in us to guide us through. As we go through the lines, Father, may we have the spiritual interpretation. Let me bring out the word according to your wish, O Jehovah in heaven. Take care of each one of us, and then we finish. For in Jesus Christ we pray and believe.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, my elder. And we go straight to our discussion, being lesson number four, looking at the quarter's lesson, which runs from May to June. We're doing lesson number four, an everlasting covenant. If you've been following with us before, we've looked at the everlasting covenant in a number of series, three series of this being the fourth. We are going to go into details of this everlasting covenant. And from our last discussion that we had, we were able to pick out that the everlasting covenant that we are looking at is a covenant that is different from how we as human beings perceive a covenant. Because a covenant for human beings is an agreement between two people. Mm-hmm. Me, for example, and my elder. So all of us, both of us have consensus on what we are supposed to do in the covenant. Mm-hmm. But in this covenant that you are looking at, it's a God-guided covenant. It's a covenant of grace that you are going to look at in detail. It's an everlasting covenant. Sister Glenna, what do we mean by everlasting covenant?
So, in the title today, you have given us two names.
Mm-hmm.
Number one, everlasting. Number two, the covenant. So something which is everlasting is something which is for eternity.
Mm-hmm.
It has
mm-hmm.
no end. So, and then the covenant is the agreement. So mm-hmm. it means that we are entering into a covenant which has eternal, has no time limit, if I can say.
Okay.
Yes.
So it's a covenant that we are looking at that is eternal, that does
yes,
not come
that is,
to...
that is taking us to eternity.
Exactly.
Yes.
Thank you. Now, I want us to just consider a brief figurative example that is given in this week's lesson. But when you were young, I remember personally when I was young, when you slept in bed, your parents used to sit by your side just to watch you, because it wasn't a good moment for either you or your parent. One, for you were feeling weak, you were feeling sick, and your parent is of course remorseful and trying to feel what is actually my child going through. Now, the writer in this week's lesson says, just so, in a figurative human sense, God sat beside of, just so in figurative human sense, God sat by the side of a sin-sick world. So moral darkness began to deepen in the centuries after the floods. And I want to shoot maybe a question to my elder Robert, even as we are looking at the introduction. The writer is already saying that morality started to darken after the floods. What does that mean? Were the morals a little bit okay after the floods, or what are we trying to get here?
Yeah, from the last the lesson number 4,
yes,
we saw how God created a remnant again now. After the floods,
yes,
there came out a remnant,
yes,
the one God wanted to use,
yes,
for his mission, for his salvation mission.
Mm-hmm.
Now, to him, this remnant was to be righteous people.
Yes.
But now, with time,
yes,
it started darkening again.
Uh-huh.
Sin started growing in it.
Uh-huh.
People started driving away from the way of life that God Christ wanted him to do. And that is why he's saying that it started darkening again. And until the point whereby, as you have said, it reached a point that is like a sin-sick bed, whereby God had to now come close and sit next to him.
So God is preserving a people for
yes,
a purpose.
About a purpose, yeah.
Thank you. And then this is why then God, for this reason, God calls Abraham for a specific reason that we are going to consider even as we go through the lessons of this week. So together with us, viewers, we want to welcome you to a study where we are going to go and look at the unfolding of more of the covenant that you've been going through, the everlasting covenant. We're going to look at the unfolding promises that have been discussed in the Bible of this everlasting covenant. And Sister Glenna, in the Bible we have our God, our Creator, identifying himself with different names. Maybe give us two names, and what are the importance of these names that God uses to identify himself with.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Thank you, Brother Robin, for the introduction. Indeed, in the Bible we have names that God calls himself, and the names that we Christian call our God.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
So the first thing, let us look at what is in a name. A name is used to identify something or someone. For example, your name is Robin.
Yes.
Robin identify who you are.
Uh-huh.
In the ancient times, people used to call out names by the experiences or the feelings, or they could be called after people. For example, the way the wives of Jacob named their children. So they named their children after certain happenings in their lives. Okay? It is the same thing even as we are naming our children. Maybe you want to name your child Faith, meaning that, or you have faith in God, or Imani, not Imani, but gifts. That child is a gift from God to you. So, in the Bible sense, we have names that God used to introduce himself to the children of Israel and also to introduce himself to Abraham. Okay? The first name here is Yahweh. And this we are seeing in the book of Genesis chapter 15 verse 17, where God is introducing himself to Abraham. He's telling him, I am Yahweh. And he continues to say, who brought you out of the land of Ur? So the first name here we are seeing is Yahweh. And there was a significance of him calling himself Yahweh to Abraham. So this Yahweh means that God, number one, is the existing one, the self-existing one. We cannot explain the existence of God. We as mortal humans, we cannot explain the existence of God. This name also shows the attributes of God. I've given one attribute of God, which is the self-existence. Another one is the virtue of faithfulness. So God explained himself to Abraham as Yahweh, number one, to show that he was, he is, and he shall be the one who is existing. Another thing, where another place where God introduced himself as Yahweh is when he was talking to Moses. And he's telling Moses, when he's sending him to Pharaoh, he's telling him, go and tell Pharaoh that I am who I am has sent you. So this means that it was to show the self-existence of God. So here God wants Abraham to know and to be able to identify the attributes of God to his name. Another name that we are given is El Shaddai. El Shaddai has two forms. We have the El and we have the Shaddai. And this word came out from the Semites. The Semites are the descendants of Shem. So this word, or this name of God, El Shaddai, comes from El, and El stands for Elohim. It comes from Elohim, the one who was existing. If you translate it to English, is the Almighty God, the Mighty God. So El stands for someone who is mighty. So we are given also an attribute of God that he is mighty. Another one is Shaddai. Shaddai is given as someone who is bound, there is bountiful that is associated with that person. So El Shaddai is a God who is mighty and also who is able to provide. We see that God is telling, I am the Almighty God who will be able to multiply your fortunes or your descendants and your livestock to give you, to make you a great nation. So it means that God, number one, is mighty. Number two, he is associated with bountifulness. Yes, so God gave these names. He introduced himself to Abraham so that he could be able to see the attributes of him to Abraham.
Thank you. My sister, for that clear definition of the names God uses to identify himself with. But I have a question. If you take a rose and you know how a rose smells, if you were to change the name of a rose from rose to, I don't know, apple maybe, would it change the smell?
No.
So the question remains. is then why does God identify specific names for himself?
God uses specific names for himself for us to be able to know him more. Mm-hmm. It's the same thing that if someone keeps calling you, for lack of a better word, stupid.
At least not me, person X.
No, yes. Okay. No, okay, for example, you have a child,
yes,
and you keep telling your child negative things.
Yes.
They will associate themselves with that negative thing. For example, if I tell my child that you're not a performer, you don't perform, you don't know anything, that child will grow up knowing I don't know anything. But in the real sense, if we associate ourselves with positive things, then we are able to know that side of God. So it's the same thing that God is giving us his name, that we might be able to know the true meaning of his name. God is introducing himself as El Shaddai, meaning that he will supply our needs. Yes, God is telling us, I am love. You cannot love someone if you don't know. So you have to know that. So that is why the names are powerful.
So in essence, what you're saying is, in this covenant, by God using specific names, we're able to have some characters, and our relationship is able to develop based on those characters. Because exactly. If you worship a God who is able to provide, then you have confidence in him that he's going to provide. So the covenant, you will be comfortable.
Imagine if God's name could be meaning a weak God. Mm. Could we really trust God?
No.
Because that we are trusting in a weak being.
Weak being, yes.
But God is telling us, my name is, and I am the Almighty God. He is a mighty God. We are comfortable associating with someone who is mighty. And then we are able to believe in him.
Yes. The name, if I can add on that, the name impacts so much on the character. Mm-hmm. And even it influences the one is thinking. Mm-hmm. Or one is, the way one perceives himself. Yeah. Mm-hmm. As Serena said, that once you call even your child, you are stupid. The child will wake up, sleep, knowing I'm stupid, or you are a fool, or you are whatever the case. So that will impact that person. Uh-huh. Even will end up being what that is. Mm. He will end up being stupid, even if he will not stop it. Yeah. So there's power in the name. And for God, there was, as I said very clear, that God could not have given weak names to himself.
Yes.
It was important for God to introduce himself to Abraham in a very strong way,
yes,
which would improve or increase Abraham's faith. Because God knew where he wanted to take Abraham.
Yes.
And he knows what Abraham would want maybe in his journey towards his fulfillment. Mm-hmm. So for Abraham to have that faith, he needs a strong base.
Yes.
And that's what God is saying, I'm abundant, I can supply, I'm a supplier, I'm almighty, I'm everything. A God who lives today, tomorrow, and forever. So Abraham will know he's now the God forever.
Like,
yes.
He was promising. I'm not going to abandon you.
Exactly.
And I will multiply, because in Genesis 17:6 it says, I will make you exceedingly fruitful, and I will make nations of you and kings of you. So it's a promise.
Exactly.
That God will do. Yes. I love the choice of word by our elder that a name influences the perception. So already if we see a powerful name of our God, then our perception to this God also changes.
Yes.
But if the meaning of the name of our God would be a fearful God, then already our perception for this God would already change.
Mm-hmm.
Now, based on the same, our elder.
Yes,
Mainga.
I come from a community whereby people believe that there is no name that a child cannot be given. And at some point, I remember a friend in high school who was called Kilikokiluku. You know, Kilikokiluku means someone with a scattered brain.
Someone with a scattered
brain. Scattered brain, yes.
Okay.
That was the name. And this fella, in school, he wasn't that smart. He didn't look quite nice. But at the end of the day, he scored a clean A. And now he's the head of medical services in my county.
Oh, okay.
Now, the biggest question that I'm asking, yes, names are important, but to a Christian today, we have never seen God, we believe in their faith. Why is it important? Why is name so important for us as Christians? Why should we focus on the different names that God is giving himself, Yahweh, Elohim, I am whom I am? Why? Why do we need to?
To answer him, God wants us to know his name, number one, because there are certain aspects of his identity that he wants us to learn. Number two, he wants us to learn his nature, his personal nature, so his character, what kind of character is God. So some of God's name reveal who he is. For example, we have given the example of Yahweh. Yahweh is someone who is the self-existing one. El Shaddai, the Almighty God, the mighty power. So through these names, we get to know the character of God. And through knowing the character of God, we are able to trust in his promises. Yes.
Thank you. Just to add to that so that we go to the next point is that as our sister explained before, a name comes with characters and characteristics attached to it. So by God identifying himself with specific names, already we have a perception, again as Elder said, of this God that we worship. So that is very key, because then God, when he identifies himself as El Shaddai, already we are getting, by hearing El Shaddai, then we are able to relate with this being because of the name that he has. And on the same note, I want to bring now my Elder to give us some more light on Abraham. Before he's Abraham, he's Abram. Why and for what reason? And what is the meaning of the two names?
Yeah, we have seen that a name, what a name has, what can a name do in one's life.
Yes.
And God, being God, he has started by introducing himself to Abraham. Uh-huh. And from here, I think Abraham must have seen the importance of these names, the impact these names has caused Abraham's mind. Yes. What picture they have portrayed in Abraham's mind, that this name, they must have an impact. So basically, when God now comes to change Abraham's name from Abraham to Abraham, Abraham now will see a sense in it. Basically, let's see. In the first sense, there is a, what they call, there's a heavy spiritual significance in every name that is given in the Bible. More especially, we can see even there are some examples. We can see, for example, Daniel. Mm-hmm. Means what? Daniel means God is my church.
Yeah.
That is what it means. Okay. Joel himself means Yahweh is God. Mm-hmm. Nathan means gift of God. Of course, these are the names we said. They have a meaning in whatever circumstances. Now, in whatever way, the names will often be changed. Why? To reflect a radical change in one's what? In one's life. Mm-hmm. We will see how Daniel, Meshach, and all they were changed to reflect the what? That reflection in their life because of the challenge to do ahead of them. What I wanted to achieve. Now, basically, even when you look at the life of Joseph or Jacob, mm-hmm. Jacob, when he restored with God, yeah, until dawn. Before God left, even Jacob didn't know he was wrestling with God, but before he left, he told him, "You have to praise me." Yeah. In his mind, he knew this was God, and God praised him by giving a new name from Jacob to Israel. Israel means what? We have seen that Israel means what? The promise that God gave to Abraham, that I will make you what? A nation, a multitude of people, many generations. That is what we see the impact of a name. Joseph in Egypt, before he became the governor, his name was changed. He became the powerful man in Egypt. He became what's called Sephrat, kind of that kind of name. So basically it's changed so much. Even Daniel himself, his name was changed. Meshach, his name was changed to Mishael to Meshach. We have Azariah to Abednego. And you know what he underwent when they were in the hands of the Babylonians. So basically, this is an example to bring us closer on why God changed the name from Abraham to Abraham. So we have seen the spiritual what significances that one has in life. Now, what about this Abraham now? What is the significance that this name Abraham?
Yes.
House. That is now our main way. Now, the name Abraham itself, the first one, the original name of Abraham, Abraham, it meant father is a God, is exalted. Mm-hmm. That is the only meaning they had, maybe from his birth. Now, God gave him the name Abraham, which means father of who? Of multitude. Now, when the multitude comes in, your mind, you click the mind that this is one of the problems they. God gave to Abraham. Yes, it's a content in what? In the promise. What? The promise.
Yeah.
So basically, God is driving something here. I'll call you a name which will aligning with your duty, aligning with your promise.
Yes.
So that is why it was important for God to change the name so that he can align Abraham to whatever mission he wants him to accomplish. That is the promise of the covenant promise. Yeah. So basically, we need to know that Abraham was given this name in a sense that there are some things God wanted to tell him. In the first place, he was given a promise that you have a son at the age of 99. So for Abraham to trust that and see that there's sense in that, he had the name has to be changed to increase what? His trust. That he may be able to trust on what? On whatever God is talking about. Mm-hmm. Secondly, all these many things that he was has been given, said from the start, from the first stage of the covenant, from being told to work, to stand up from who, to move to a new place. All that they need a lot of faith, yeah? So basically the name change, it abbreviated the standards of Abraham's faith. It grew. So that whenever he goes now, whatever he speaks with God, because God had introduced himself to him,
yes.
Now he has given a new name. Now it's like now they are correlating and they are in the same book. Yeah? So that gave him the abbreviation of the faith of Abraham so that he can do what? He can be able to live within the promise, what? The covenant promises on his way towards achieving what God wants him to do. That is the faith of God's promises.
Thank you. Yes, Brother Mangi.
We have what we call Christian names. A Christian name is a name that you are given upon baptism. Other than not, is whereby children are given Christian names when they are being born. Is there any significance, is there any relationship between us getting a Christian name when we are baptized? There are communities which never give. Is there any relationship between such names and our salvation or our acceptance to follow Jesus?
Good question. So is there any relationship between the names that we choose to our children at baptism, you said?
Yes. At baptism, yeah. Mm-hmm.
So at baptism.
Or even at birth. Some parents
even
give
at
children
birth.
Names at birth.
Yes. Is there any relationship between that and our salvation?
You know, initially,
yes.
Those days,
yes.
When children were born,
yes.
They were not given Christian names, you can remember. Those days,
mm-hmm.
They were given surnames, depending on their lineage. Yeah. Their uncles, their fathers, their grandfathers, whichever the case. And in a new sense that one was given a Christian name after baptism. When you are baptized, it was taken that you have now made a decision and you have known what it means. And they call them Christian names because those names came from there. Most of them were the disciples, those who were biblical names, yeah? Which have a meaning. Because every name here in the Bible, most of them have meanings. That is, you can relate them to a meaning. So that is what's supposed to be. It was supposed to be that the entire time. That after baptism is when you get a Christian name.
Mm-hmm.
Me, I was called Mongare. Mongare is a name of a prominent person in Kisii those days. I don't even know him.
So you should be prominent today.
That is why, in my mind, he said, my mind, I must be prominent. I must be like that man. You see?
Mm-hmm.
But now, after baptism is when I wanted to be called Robert. You see? I brought Robert in. I don't even know where I got it from. But it's a Christian name. So basically, Christian names are there to make a change in one's life. Make a change in one's life that you have changed. Now you have known Christ because baptism is all about dying with sin and what? Threatening with what? With God.
To me, I will say it like this. When you have an encounter with God, your situation changes. And one of the things that also changes is your name. Jacob had an encounter with God and his name
changed.
Daniel had an encounter with God and his name changed. It means us in our fallen nature, when we have an encounter with God, our situation, our
changes.
Names also changes. That is what I mean.
Thank you. And also maybe to add to the question by Brother Mainga, I think also the reason why we have Christian names, as my sister said, is to create that perception. However, I need to point I would stand to be corrected, is it is not necessarily to mean that if you have that Christian name, then you're saved. Now, salvation is the process that now you need to make that commitment between you and God.
To have a relationship.
To have a relationship with your God. The name is that milestone, if I would use that language, that you've now gone past. Then now, going forward, you need now to
cultivate
a relationship between you and your God. I want to go now, after looking at God identifying himself with quite powerful names, and he's the giver of this everlasting covenant. And we've looked at Abraham, whose name changes from Father Exalted to Father of a Multitude, to align with what promise God had. Maybe Brother Mainga, could you take us through the steps that a covenant has? The stages, sorry, rather.
Yes, before I start with the stages of the covenant, I would like to highlight something about the covenant that is here. The covenant is between Yahweh and Abraham. But virtually, the promise and the covenant extends to the descendants of Abraham, the generations that were tied to Abraham. And subsequently, the same covenant is extended to the whole world. So we are having two people. We have God and we are having Abraham. Now, as we even continue, the question that I would first want us to understand is, the aspect that I want us to understand is this. This is not a covenant which was imposed on Abraham, but it was a covenant which was based on choices, obedience, and willingness.
Free will.
Mm-hmm. Do that. Mm-hmm. You know, sometimes we even get personal. We get very personal the way we execute things. You get something, you get a job, and it is a personal thing. You know? If you sign a contract between you and the employer, it is something that you seek to execute because it is an agreement between both of you. Uh-huh. If Abraham could have been selfish and said, no, it is me and God, we probably could not have been beneficiaries to the plan of salvation. Mm-hmm. But anyway, God could have used his ways to ensure that happens. Now, I'm talking about, my assignment is to talk about the
stages
of covenant.
Yes.
The lesson is highlighting to us three stages of the covenant. And the first three stages of the covenant, the first one begins with a promise, which is found in Genesis chapter 12, verse 1 and 2, which says, the Lord had said to Abraham, leave your country, your people, and your father's household, and go to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. That was the promise which kept Abraham moving. The first part of the covenant.
Mm-hmm.
So it is God himself presenting himself to Abraham, calling him from wherever he was, and telling him that I have a promise, I have a good plan for you. I want to make you a great nation. But for you to do that, now we go now to the second step. Whereby he's told, you have to leave the land of your father and your mother. When you go to Genesis chapter 15, that's where we find that. From verse 7, when we are told, he also said to him, I am the Lord who brought you out of Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land to take possession of it. Now, God is telling Abraham, I've already called you from there, the first stage, but now I want to give you something. This land for possession of it. There are questions that come into play when we talk of this land. Abraham is also asking God, how will I be sure that you are giving me a land? If today you came to me and I told you, come and do this to me, I'm going to give you a piece of land. You'll be asking, but how will I know?
Probably
need a title deed, a lease, and you know how difficult it is. But God is telling Abraham, he wants to give him a land which is already occupied by the Amorites. He's asking him, how will I know? You know what you are telling me is next to
possession. Sure, yes.
How do I know? Then he tells him, he gets to a covenant, he tells him, bring me these animals as a sacrifice. And when he got them, he told him, slaughter them. When he slaughtered them, in the evening, Abraham was taken by this sheep. And then God appeared to Abraham and sealed the covenant, the promise. That was the promise that he sealed, that is going to be a piece of land. So after giving that promise, we move to the next part, which is chapter 17 of Genesis, whereby God tells Abraham, yes, I have called you and I want to make you a great nation through your descendants and even to eternity, but for me to have a covenant with you, we have to seal this covenant. There should be a sign between me and you about the covenant. And the covenant, the sign that God gave Abraham was circumcision. Abraham had to go through humiliation. Today I would say, for example, telling my father to go and be circumcised, it's humiliation. But Abraham was circumcised at 99 years, and he never complained. Because the issue was obedience and willingness to abide by God. Now, how does it now become an everlasting covenant? When you look in the book of Galatians chapter 3, Galatians chapter 3 verse 6 says, consider Abraham, he believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. Understand then that those who believe are children of Abraham. The scripture foresaw that God would justify the Gentiles by faith and announce the gospel in advance to Abraham. All nations will be blessed through you. So those who have faith are blessed along with Abraham, the man of faith. We are Gentiles because we are not born as Jews. The only way that we got into this covenant between Abraham and God, it is only through our faith in Jesus Christ. When we get to Jesus through our faith in him, we become children of Abraham, and in that we become descendants. On the other side, if we do not have faith in Jesus Christ, then there is no covenant. We stand lost like anyone else who is not part of the covenant.
Thank you, Brother Mainga. Unfortunately, the time is not on our side, but I want us to pick just one thing clearly from our discussion from the last lessons and even the lesson that we are doing today. The covenant that we are looking at here is a covenant of grace. And man is getting what actually is not rightfully his. So God is giving us not based on our actions, but based on grace, and us receiving by faith. And this is why God is choosing Abraham as an instrument to assist in proclaiming the plan of salvation of this world. But the fulfillment of this covenant is based on the acceptance or willingness. The consent, the willingness of who?
Abraham.
But Sister Glenna, if Abraham was not to consent or agree, would this covenant be?
No.
So his consent was to be there.
It was important.
It was important.
Yes.
And the other question is the obedience of Abraham to God, was it key in this covenant?
Obedience to God from Abraham was very key, because we know that if there's obedience leads to unfaithfulness.
Uh-huh.
If there's unfaithfulness,
so where
to
there's
an established relationship.
Sorry to cut you short. Where there's obedience, there's faithfulness.
Yes.
Where there's disobedience, there's unfaithfulness.
Unfaithfulness. And okay. If there's unfaithfulness to any covenant or relationship or whatever,
yes.
That means that thing is not fulfilled. It
cannot be fulfilled.
It cannot be fulfilled. And the effect of it cannot be. He arrived at.
Thank you.
Yeah. I'm asking a question.
Yes.
Genesis 17:9.
Yes.
Then God said to Abraham, mm-hmm. As for you, you must keep my covenant. You and your descendants,
mm-hmm.
after you, for the generations to come.
Yes.
Do you think God gave Abraham a choice?
Yes, good
you
question.
Must.
According to that verse, Sister Glenna, God is saying you must. Is it one way that Abraham had one option, obey and obey?
No, to me, I feel Abraham had an option. Abraham accepted. He could accept, he could not accept. But he made a choice to be obedient.
Mm-hmm.
So that his choice of being obedient helped the fulfillment of the covenant. If Abraham was to be disobedient, then God could not use him. Abraham had a part to play. And his part to play was to obey or disobey. He had to make a choice. God gives us choices. You obey me, you do this. You disobey me, you do this. So Abraham had a choice to obey God. And he faithfully made that choice,
mm-hmm.
because he already knew the God he's dealing with. Yes.
Thank you. I want to read a small part here, even as we plan to do our last statement.
Maybe on
together.
That, before you read that.
Yes, yes.
This statement, they say here that uh-huh. When the covenant is broken,
mm-hmm.
what is broken is not the condition
yes.
of the bestowal, but the condition of fulfillment.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if Abraham had
disobeyed and not even contented with that covenant,
mm-hmm.
that means God could have even used other ways,
mm-hmm.
or could have used someone else.
Mm-hmm.
But before God comes to you, mm-hmm. what I know that before comes to use you, God knows you.
Yes.
And he has put all the means and the ways to make you.
Because even the Bible says that Abraham was righteous before God.
Before what?
And that is why God used him in this.
Be confident that this is a man before my.
Mm-hmm.
He is a man from my own confidence.
And I actually want to add to what you are saying. In Genesis 18:19, the Bible says, "For I know him." Now this is God
Correct.
Speaking of Abraham.
Exactly.
"For I know him that he will command his children and his household after him. And they shall keep the way of the Lord,
yes.
do justice and judgment,
mm.
that the Lord may bring upon Abraham that which he has spoken of him."
Yeah, that's
so
why
God knew Abraham
yeah.
and trusted Abraham.
Mm.
Yes.
And if he commanded his children,
yes.
and that generation will be commanded towards the end, Baka, he fulfilled the promise.
Thank you very much. I want just to give a question maybe to our class. Maybe I will allow one person to respond. Abraham is called to go to a land that is not identified at that moment.
Mm-hmm.
Is it possible that today we could be called, maybe not to a land that is not clear to us, but on other circumstances, could we be receiving the same call that Abraham received then?
Mm. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
We receive the call through the scriptures.
Mm-hmm.
Remember, we are told that we have been given the Great Commission to spread the gospel to all parts of the world.
Yeah.
And so God calls us out of our comfort zone. Go and spread the gospel.
The gospel.
So we are called out, come out of that well-paying job and come and do my work. Come out of your comfort zone and come and do my work.
Which is not clear when you're leaving your job and you don't know where you go.
But we have a God whom we can trust.
We can trust.
Yes.
So the element is trust, not
yes.
where you're going.
I trust him.
You trust
so
him.
So he knows the process already.
Yes.
Mine is to make that step forward. I have come.
Agree or
I
disagree?
I have agreed. So the next, show me.
Thank you. In the interest
yeah.
of time.
Yes, when Abraham was called from Ur to
yes.
the new place,
yes.
he had an option to refuse.
Uh-huh.
Because where you stay, like I can imagine Hur, Abraham had the parents, Abraham had the
family,
had relatives,
yeah.
had land, had wealthy. So those are things could have forced him to what? To pull back.
Yeah.
To disobey.
Like now you're telling me, I leave my mansionette house
yes.
here, I had to go out,
go.
Leave this house.
And live in a tent.
And go and live in a tent for
it's
10
not
years.
Not even reveal if you're
not
going to live
tent.
In a tent.
In
the you're
distance.
Told to go.
Yes.
Yeah. Go,
you
just leave, go.
Yes.
And do so. Even if I know where I'm going,
yes.
when you tell me what to Philippines or go to Turkana,
yes.
I live in a tent and you spread the word.
Yes.
You stay there for 2 months, moving on down, doing this. I leave my comfort in my house. It becomes so difficult. Why? Because nowadays we have become worshippers of what we have. God has blessed us with so much, but we end up worshiping what God has blessed us with. That is what we forget. That is what is keeping us hostage, that we cannot fulfill God's promise. As the sister said, that we have a mission. From the beginning, God told us, until and unless the word
has been fulfilled to all corners
of the
world,
then
I will bring
the kingdom.
Yes.
So he's not bringing the kingdom because we have not left our comfort zones to go and do what? And do that.
Preach.
Not only physically going there, but even using resources. We are told that even if you cannot go, you can only bridge like Paul.
Let's
you can use yes, it's a bridge. We are so mean. We can't even leave the resources.
My technical team is telling me that you are time bad, and I wanted to give you a last statement, but because you spoke and he spoke, I'll give my Inge. Be faithful to the 1 minute I'm giving you.
The issue is not the faithfulness, but the content of what the question that I want to put across. The question is, God is calling Abraham and telling him, I want to give you this land, a land which is already inhabited by the Amorites. And he tells him that your descendants will be taken into slavery. And your fourth generation will be brought back. If today someone came and gave you a promise, including slavery of your own children, will you still cling to that promise or you'll think twice? Our God is a faithful God. He knew his way. So at the end of the day, he knew that the obedience, the ability to obey, and the willingness to execute the promise was the covenant was not at Abraham's disposal, but God also had to play a role in helping Abraham for him to be able to protect that task and ensure that he delivers results. In the middle of the way, many people died. For God to be faithful in this part of the covenant, people are dying. For now, what is there is we have to be faithful. There is a price that we have to pay so that we also honor our part of the covenant with God.
Thank you, panel, and thank you, viewers, for watching. As you can see clearly, time is not sufficient for us to discuss everything. I will invite you to go ahead and get a lesson of this. Please do discuss with a family, with a friend, in details, where time is not limited. Here, time is limited. And because of that, I say thank you for being with us. Sister Glenna, please close for us with a prayer.
Thank you. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time. We thank you for the opportunity you have granted us to listen to thy word. Thank you, Father, for teaching us about the covenant that you made with Abraham that reflects on our salvation, dear Father. We praise you as we continue with the Sabbath. May you grant us thy Holy Spirit. May he help us to develop a relationship with you. Be with us now and forevermore, for this is my prayer in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Thank you and happy Sabbath.
Thank you so much.
Our next song is 573. I'll go where you want me to go. It may not be. Let's sing together. It may not be on the mountain heights or over the stormy sea. It may not be at the battle's front. My Lord will have need of me. But if by still small voice he calls to paths that I do not know, I'll answer thee, Lord, with thy hand in thine. I'll go where you want me to go. I'll go where you want me to go, dear Lord, over mountain or plain or sea. I'll say what you want me to say, dear Lord. I'll be what you want me to be. Perhaps today their loving words with Jesus will help me speak. There may be now in the paths of sin someone whom I should seek. O Savior, if thou wilt be my guide, though dark and rugged the way, my voice shall echo the message sweet. I'll say what you want me to say. I'll go where you want me to go, dear Lord, over mountain or plain or sea. I'll say what you want me to say, dear Lord. I'll be what you want me to be. There's surely somewhere a lowly place in us the best fields so wide, where I may labor through life's short day for Jesus the crucified. So trusting my own to claim the care, and knowing thou lovest me, I'll do thy will with a heart sincere. I'll be what you want me to be. I'll go where you want me to go, dear Lord, over mountain or plain or sea.
I'll say what you want me to say, dear Lord. I'll be what you want me to be.
We have an obligation to do the tithes and offering. You remember that last week we had a steward Shabbat. We are taught so much on how we can give to the Lord in terms of resources, in terms of time, and in terms of whatever we do, even our bodies. So let us be very prompt in paying our tithes and offering. Then we remember we have our development project going on. It has started. We have the apparatum block, which is being brought up, the children's sanctuary. The foundation is taken off, and now we need to join together, all of us, as we gather the resources. We request the church to continue to redeem their pledges. You know how much you're blessed, and you want you to redeem, and even you, the new ones come in and give us some more resources that we'll be able to bring out the children's sanctuary and even the apparatum block for our better use. God is using his people every time again. Even if there is this session of not coming to church, but we need to continue the work of God. So I pray that you may continue to redeem your pledges as we continue to do God's work in his vineyard. Thank you, and God bless you. I wish you a blessed Sabbath. Thank you, and bless God bless you.
We give thee but thine own. Whatever gift may be, all that we have is thine, O Lord. I trust, O Lord, from thee. Amen.
Jesus loved the little children, all the children of the world. They are precious in this world. Jesus loved the little children of the world. Happy Sabbath, children. My name is Melissa Kwamboka. I'm going to tell you the story today, and it comes from the book of Jeremiah chapter 18. The title is The Potter and the Clay. And before I start the story, let us pray. Oh God, thanks for giving us this day, mighty Father. As I start this story, mighty Father, help them to understand. And God, help, just speak through me so that they can understand. Give them the spirit of understanding. In Jesus' name I pray and I believe. Amen. Yes, so one day, God sent Jeremiah to the potter's house. And he told him to observe what he was doing. And from there, he would send him other instructions. So Jeremiah did as he was told, and he went to the potter's house. When he arrived, he found the potter sitting on his wheel, and he was molding a vessel. And after a while of molding the vessel, it did not turn out the way he wanted. So he crushed it into a lump of clay and remolded it again. And so God told Jeremiah, I want you to go to the people of Israel and tell them, as the clay is in the potter's hands, you are also in my hands. And if I wanted to destroy you and you turn away from evil and be good, I won't destroy you. But if I wanted to raise you and you go to the ways of evil, I will destroy you. And so Jeremiah went and told the people of Israel, and they refused to repent. And from this story, we learn that we are in God's hands, just as the clay is in the potter's hands. And we should learn to accept God, and we should allow him to remold us and make us into useful vessels. And we should also believe in him. Amen. Let's pray. Oh God, thanks for giving us this day. Thank you for making us understand the story. In Jesus' name, amen.
Happy Sabbath once again. Our next song is Wonderful, Merciful Savior.
wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend, who'd have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men. Oh, you rescued the souls of men. Counselor, Comforter, Keeper, Spirit we long to embrace. You offer hope when our hearts are hopelessly lost away. Oh, we've hopelessly lost the way. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. Infinite Father, faithfully loving your own, hearing the weakness you find us falling before your throne. Oh, we falling before your throne. You are the we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. You are the one we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
welcome to today's fellowship. Our Lord is good. He has allowed us to have fellowship online. He will bless us today. He is a great God. Today's message title is One Day at a Time. One day at a time. What did I say? One day at a time. And our guiding verse will come from the book of Matthew, chapter 6, verse 34. Matthew, chapter 6, verse 34. And I'm going to read from the King James Version. And it reads this way. Take therefore no thought for the morrow, for the morrow shall take thought of the things of itself. Full stop. And it continues. Sufficient unto the day is the evil therefore. Brothers and sisters, I love King James Version. When you listen to this verse, when you read it, you can notice that when you're reading from King James Version, then many people are left out. They don't get the meaning clearly. And for that reason, we shall read another version to have a very clear meaning. And we're going to read from the New International Version, NIV. NIV, Matthew 6, chapter 34, it says this. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Full stop. Then it says, every day has enough trouble of itself. This now gives us a direction. The Bible says that when you should not worry about tomorrow. And this is the message that we have today. Brothers and sisters, let us pray before we start this message.
Now, dear Lord, as we pray, take our hearts and minds far away from the press of the world all around to your throne.
Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, speak to us this morning. Teach us how to take a day at a time. Move us in this sermon. Put your words in my mouth and guide us. For in Jesus' name, we pray and believe.
I'm only human, I'm just a woman. Help me believe in what I could be and all that I am. Show me the stairway. I hope to climb, Lord, for my sake, teach me to take one day at a time. One day at a time, sweet Jesus, that's all asking from you. Just give me the strength to do every day what I have to do. Yesterday's gone, sweet Jesus, and tomorrow may never be mine. Lord, help me today. Show me the way, one day at a time. Do you remember when you walked among men? Well, Jesus, you know, if you're looking below, it's worse now than then. Pushing and shouting, that's crowded my blood. So for my sake, teach me to take one day at a time. One day at a time, sweet Jesus, that's all I'm asking of you. Just give me the strength to do every day all I have to do. Yesterday's gone, sweet Jesus, and tomorrow may never be mine. Lord, help me today, show me the way, one day at a time. One day at a time, Jesus, that's all I'm asking of you. Just give me the strength to do every day what I have to do. Yesterday's gone, sweet Jesus, and tomorrow may never be mine. Lord, help me today. Show me the way, one day at a time. Lord, help me today. Show me the way, one day at a time.
One day at a time. One day at a time is a phrase or an idiom. And an idiom is where you take words and brings them together, then they form a meaning. A meaning that is different from their individual meaning. We are saying that every word with its individual meaning, they come together and they form another meaning apart from their individual meaning, and that is an idiom. One day at a time is also an idiom. So when we say one day at a time, what we mean is doing things step by step or one at a time. When you do things step by step or one at a time, it can also mean facing the day's problems as they come, without, instead of worrying about the future. You deal with things the way they come, deal with issues the way they come, instead of worrying about the future, one day at a time. This is the message that we have today. And you will realize we do not mean that one should not plan. This message does not suggest that we should not plan for our future. Planning is paramount. Everyone needs to plan. This country plans, and that is why we have the 2030 vision. The churches plan for the future. Individuals plan for the future. You as an individual, you need to plan your retirement, how you will retire. You need to plan for your children. You need to plan maybe sometimes 8 years in advance. But what the message is saying today is, you can plan for 8 years, but you cannot live all the 8 years in a day. And that is why we are praying today that God teaches us to live one day at a time. I have heard people say that the Chinese have a proverb, and this proverb goes like this. They say that a journey of 1,000 miles starts with a step. This is the same thing. The Chinese embraces this message one day at a time. They know if they want to cover 1,000 miles, they have to start a day, a step after a step, until the 1,000 miles are covered. Brothers and sisters, we see the Chinese as a country. They are developed, they look developed, and maybe it is because of embracing this message of one day at a time. We are living in a world today, a world that you cannot predict the future. You cannot know what will happen tomorrow or next week. Someone was telling me, if you go to your rural area and you hear the president addressing the nation, when he says, fellow Kenyans, look for the next motorbike to leave where you are, to leave your rural area and rush back to Nairobi, or get into your car and drive back. This is living with an uncertainty. We don't know what will happen to us. Brothers and sisters, because of this, that's why we're saying today, one day at a time. You look at the servant of God, his name is David, when he writes the Psalms, Psalms chapter 118, verse 24, David says these words. He says, Psalms chapter 118, verse 24, and I'm going to read from the King James Version. David says these words. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice in it and be glad in it. Yes, this is a prophetic verse. It is talking of the day of the Lord. When Christ shall come to this world, we are expected to rejoice. We are expected to be glad seeing Christ. But this verse also applies to our day-to-day life. It is telling us, like David took it, David appreciates a day. He knows that this day has come from God. He is glad with this day. He rejoices with the day. And this is also the message that David is giving us. When we see a new day, let us rejoice and be glad in it and live that day with all that it has. It is a day from the Lord. Hallelujah. Our message today, one day at a time. There is a time as a church we had a music Sabbath, and we invited groups of singers to come and worship with us. We also invited a chief speaker, the chief guest, we invited him. He came with a wife. The chief speaker's name was Evangelist Professor Achia. He came with a wife, Doreen. This wife, his wife also was singing, but she's a solo singer. She sang that day many songs.
And one song that she sang, the title was One Day at a Time. This song came very strongly to us because she sang with a very strong voice. It made an impression to all of us in the church. Later on, this song started ringing in my head, and I wanted to sing it, but I didn't have the words. I was forced to go checking for the words online. I got the words, and as I was singing the song, it made more great impression to me, and I saw it was a blessing to me. The song was a blessing, and for that reason, I went a step further to look at the person who composed the song or who wrote the song, to know under what circumstances did this person write this song. And I found out that the person who wrote the song is also a lady called Mary Jones. I went online to know all this. Then I realized Mary Jones wrote this song or composed the song when she was 53 years. She was born in a Christian family, and as she grew up, she was singing in church. But as she grew up with this talent, she stopped singing in church, and she joined a cowboy group to sing country music. She sang many hits, and these hits brought her great fortune. She became wealthy, but again she realized, as much as she's wealthy, she was not getting peace in her life. She was talking to herself, and she says, if I would continue singing in church, then I would not live a frustrated life that I am living now. She was frustrated, very wealthy, but frustrated. She became alcoholic, and the husband also became alcoholic. And to make matters worse, the husband was also involved in multiple relationship. This drained Mary Jones. She became very frustrated. And the last straw was when her mother died. She went down, and she almost lost herself. Then one day she decided, on her way home, she will go into a church to talk to a minister or a pastor. And this is exactly what she did. She went into the church, and she found a young pastor, and she talked to the pastor. She needed to be counseled. She told the pastor her problems, and the pastor prayed with her. But the pastor would, before she left, the pastor would ask her, you look very wealthy. And she would respond by saying, yes, I am wealthy. Because she had driven in that church with a metallic blue Cadillac, a heavy machine. She was dressed like a celeb. She had bling all over. And this pastor looked at this lady in her cowboy boots. She looked like she was okay. And the pastor was shocked. He even asked her, you look healthy. The lady said, yes, I think I'm healthy. Then the pastor told her one thing. He told the lady, have you ever thanked God for your problems? This did not go well with the lady. She wondered how should she thank God because of problems. But this, here she was, the pastor has said. So when she left the church, she left with this in mind. When she reached her home, she went straight to her piano and started playing the piano. It is this day that she'll compose the song, One Day at a Time. She composed the song And after realizing it is a powerful song, it is a prayer, she wrote it down. This was a breakthrough in her life. After singing the song, she had peace. And we shall go through one stanza of the song. In her song, she is talking to Jesus Christ. And she tells Jesus Christ, Jesus Christ, one day at a time, sweet Jesus. One day at a time, sweet Jesus. This is all that I am asking of you. She is telling Jesus Christ, teach me how to live one day at a time. Jesus Christ, this is all I am asking of you. Then she continues in the next sentence. She says, just give me the strength to do every day what I have to do. Christ, I don't need more energy to do everything. What I want, since you know me, give me the strength that I need for this day. Then she becomes emotional in the next sentence. She says these words, yesterday has gone, sweet Jesus. Like she's telling Christ, she has gone through a lot of suffering. She has suffered in her life. Jesus Christ, put this suffering behind me. She tells Christ, put this pain behind me. Christ, forgive me my sins. Christ, yesterday is gone, sweet Jesus. Then she continues by saying this, and tomorrow may never be mine. Jesus Christ, I don't want to care about the future. I'm not even sure if I will be alive tomorrow. Only Christ, care for me, because the next sentence he says, just help me today. Show me the way. One day at a time, she realized this is a prayer. She wrote it down. And this was peace to her. From that time, she continued composing Christian songs. Hallelujah. Jesus Christ gave her peace. Brothers and sisters, you could be listening to this message. You are financially stable like this lady. You are doing well financially, but you could be going through a difficult moment. And you are emotionally down. You are spiritually down. You are physically unstable. And many, many other issues. You're going through many issues. The message today is one day at a time. We want to ask God, God, teach us to take one day at a time. Praise God. This is our message today. Tell God to teach you to live one day at a time. Amen. One day at a time, sweet Jesus, that's all I'm asking of you. Show me one day. I'm trying to sing that song because this song gives me peace. And I would want also you to sing the same song to give you peace. It is a prayer. Brothers and sisters, one day a member of the church called me and he wanted to talk to me. So I told him, let us meet in church and talk. When I came to the church, I met the member and we prayed together. Then I asked him, what did you want to tell me? The member told me, have you ever thought of taking a sword and chopping someone into small pieces? I was shocked and I looked at the member straight on his face. I realized he is serious because the eyes were wet, the eyes were red. Then I told him, I have never thought of doing that. And I asked him, why do you think that, does that go through your mind? Then he told me, my brother, do you know where my house is? I said, yes. That house sits on a land that I don't have the papers. What? Yes. Then he told me, for many years since he bought the land, he's been struggling to get these papers, but in vain. This person who sold to him the land, he has been dodging him here and there. And now he tells me the person has reached a point he does not pick his calls. He has gone dead through his phone. So my brother is frustrated. Then he tells me, this is why this thing is crossing my mind. I feel like cutting this person into pieces. I told him, yes, I can see where you're coming from. I can see why this is coming, crossing your mind. It is not easy, my brother. But think about yourself. After doing that, chopping that person into pieces, what next? What happens to your wife? What happens to your children? Because you will have killed this person. You'll be arrested and taken to a maximum life sentence or being hanged. What happens to your wife? What happens to your children? They will lose that land. They will be outside there, struggling, and you in prison, not able to do anything to your family. The devil wants to destroy you. The devil wants to destroy your life. Then I asked him, let us kneel down to pray. Brothers and sisters, we knelt down and we prayed and we asked God, God, we are going to pray for 5 days. In these 5 days, God, we expect you to intervene. Father, this is not now matters that are light. We need your urgent intervention. We prayed and left church. Exactly 5 days, we met again. I met this church member. After praying, I asked him, any report from this man? And he said, yes, he has called me. We rejoiced and we said, that is enough. Just like Elijah, when he was praying for rain, he sent his servant 2-3 times, go and check if there is any cloud. The last time the servant went, he came and said, he's seeing a cloud the size of the palm. And we talked with my brother. This is enough. Just like Elijah was contended with that small cloud, this calling is enough for us. Let us pray again and ask God. We gave God again now 7 days. Say, God, we are giving you, we are taking 7 days, and we're going to pray that you intervene in a mighty way. We prayed for 7 days and met in church, and I asked him, how far have you gone? He told me he has gone with a very big speed. Hallelujah. This is the intervention of God. To cut the whole story short, this man today, this member of our church today, has his papers. This is the God that we are worshiping. This is the God that we worship even today. He is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. When I was talking to this friend of mine, we then realized, me and him, that more other people in our church, we are going through the same problem. There are people who don't have papers. They have built their houses. And he agreed with him, we will pray for them. Even if we know them or not, we will have a blanket prayer for all the members of this church so that they can get their papers. Some of them, we got to know their names, and we were praying, mentioning their names, and some not. Up to now, we have had testimonies. I have had testimonies of four families praising God that they now have their papers, or they are in the process of getting the whole papers. Hallelujah. This is God. Brothers and sisters, God is real. Trust Him. Tell Him what you have. He will intervene in your problems. You would ask me, why have you told us this story? Yes, I will answer. This church member, because I've cut the story short, as we were talking to him, he also had other issues. But I remember one day I told him, my brother, take one day at a time. He would come to tell me later on that this was a message, a medicine to him. From that day, he took one day at a time. He has experienced some peace that surpasses all human understanding. He would also be a blessing to me. When I am down and I meet him, he tells me, Elder, one day at a time, and I would find blessing or peace from this word. I have realized then, one day at a time, it is not a statement made only one day. You need to make it every day. This body would take you very far. You have to remind this body every day. This body, tell it one day at a time. When it wants to go out, you tell it one day at a time. And this way, you will overcome. Hallelujah. One day at a time. Brothers and sisters, just like this church member, you could also be going through difficult moments, maybe of the plot or something easy, similar. Let this information be known to God. Tell God like we told God. We prayed and asked God to intervene. He intervened. When we read Philippians chapter 4, verse 6 and 7, we get this strong message. Philippians chapter 4, verse 6 and 7, and it says, be careful for nothing. That is King James. But other versions will tell you, do not be anxious. Don't care a lot. Don't worry. So King James says, be careful for nothing, but for everything, by prayers and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your request be known, be made known unto God. Tell God what you're going through, whatever the situation. Tell God what you're going through. And verse 7 is powerful. It starts like this. And the peace of God, hallelujah. And the peace of God. And the peace of God that passes all you, that passes all understanding, shall keep your heart and minds through Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. This peace is what we are looking for at this time. This peace is what everyone is looking for. And Christ says, make your request made known to him, and he will give you this peace. Hallelujah. Our message today, one day at a time. We have gone through a month or 4 months, very tight months or weeks. We are even receiving a call from your phone is scary. Sometimes I have individuals who in one day have received information that two of their friends have died, or relatives have died, close family members have died, colleagues, and they will all start, when they are calling you, they will start with them, do you know this person? When they start like that, you are scared and you can guess what they want to tell you. Sometimes you are tempted to tell them, don't tell me what you want to say. And they will conclude by telling you, that is what has happened. It is not easy. And it has not been easy for every one of us. I received such a call. And I was told, your cousin has passed away. He went to bed, a healthy man, but he never woke up. It was not easy. We were very close, and we would do things together. And he died. After 3 days, the wife woke me in sleep. She called me, and she was wailing, crying and saying a lot of things. I had no words to console her, so I allowed her to cry over the phone. When I realized she was going to stop, I told her, God is in control. I know very well she didn't take that serious. She had nothing to take with such a consolation. And I called her later in the day, and I told her, God is in control. She was complaining. She was lamenting. She has very young children. She's a young lady. The future is dark. She didn't know what to do with the future. She's crying, what will happen? And the message today is one day at a time. I am praying that God teaches my cousin's wife how to live one day at a time. Because if you take all these things together, you will be overwhelmed. There are so many people in her state today. They are crying. The future is dark. They don't know how to maneuver through the future. We are praying today. We are asking God today, God, teach us, also teach them how to take one day at a time. When you take a day at a time, it is consoling. It is a blessed thing. Brothers and sisters, one day at a time. If you ask a parent today, what class is your child? Some of them will tell you, sincerely speaking, I don't know. One will tell you, maybe class 5 or 6. They don't know. And it is true, they don't know. People are overwhelmed. If you ask the child now, what class are you in? The child will tell you, we were told if we go to the next term, we shall be moving to class 7 physically to give space to the preschool children who are joining. But in instance, they will tell you, we are still in class 6 and going for third term. We are not in class 7. This preschool who are joining, they are joining school for the first time. And they are told you're joining in the third term. If you don't teach these children to live one day at a time, they will be overwhelmed. You would think it's a small thing to them. But this is overwhelming. Ask God to teach you to live one day at a time. Ask God to help you teach your children to live one day at a time. If you talk to the ambassadors and ask them, when are you graduating? They will tell you, we don't know. And you ask why, some of them cannot even talk to you. They will wonder, where do you come from? Don't you see what is happening? Ambassadors, one day at a time. The youth, this is and a majority of the youth, this is a frustrated lot. They have many issues, ranging from unemployment, unstable employment. They don't know what the future holds them. They are engaging in relationships that are not working. They are scared into entering in relationships. Today you are invited into a pre-wedding, tomorrow it's cancelled. Tomorrow is there is a wedding is cancelled. And some of this wedding will never happen again. Tell me when you're talking to someone who went to a wedding expecting the bridegroom to come, and she didn't come, and he didn't come. How do you talk to this person? The only thing to say is, take one day at a time. If this youth would learn to take a day at a time, then this would be a great blessing in their lives. Hallelujah. One day at a time. We know we are all overwhelmed. It is not the youth alone, the children, the parents, everyone, or the majority of people living now. We are overwhelmed by this situation. But let us look at this key verse microscopically. Matthew chapter 6, verse 34. But before we read verse 34, let us read verse 33 and connect the two. When you connect the two, now the message will go home. These are words that are proceeding from the mouth of the Lord. This is Christ in the mountain speaking these words, and he starts verse 33. Seek you first the kingdom of God and its righteousness. Christ is telling you, do you want to have a wedding? Seek Christ first. Do you want to start a business? God first. Do you want to leave your job? God first. Do you want to do a transfer? Seek God first and his righteousness. Then he says, all these things shall follow you. He doesn't stop there. So verse 34 will start. Therefore, now therefore connects the two verses. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Every day have enough problem of its own. Brothers and sisters, every day deal with the issues of the day. Don't get overwhelmed by the situation of this world. And that is why the lady is saying, yesterday is gone and tomorrow will never be mine. Help me today. Show me the way. One day at a time. Hallelujah. Let us embrace the message for today. One day at a time. There's a lady who was admitted in a government institution. She was there for some time, and she got tired of life, and she would be heard saying, I have stayed for long in this office, this hospital, in the ward. I no longer desire to leave. She would remove all the drips or the support they've put on her. She removes them. And the nurses would check and notice that. They would come rushing and fit them again. And she will do the same. This will go on for some time until the nurses get tired. They were getting tired with her. And lucky enough, the visitation time comes. The mother joins in. She's told by the nurses, your child wants to die. She goes on that bed. She pleads with her. She helps the nurses to return the drip and the rest, talking to the child. This is the frustration many people are going through. An elder called me, an elder from a different church, and he asked me, Elder, what is this flu or cold that is not ending? He was not talking about COVID. He told me there's a cold, a flu that is going around, and it is true. There is a flu that is going around. It is not COVID. It attacks you, breaks your joints. It wants you to sleep 24 hours with a slight cough that does not go out. So you stay sometimes up to 2 weeks suffering from this flu. So the elder is wondering, what is happening? Maybe the same is happening to a church member today. You're suffering from this cold, from this flu. Don't get tired. You wake up, it is the same. Every day you wake up, it's the same. If you embrace this message, one day at a time, with all this pain, take a day at a time. As you continue to pray, God will see you through. If you don't do that, you will be like the frustrated lady in that ward. One day at a time. Even if that day is painful, take it the way it is. Continue moving. One day at a time. People have tested positive. Some are in the houses. Some are admitted. Some in ICU. With all that pain, if this message reaches such kind of people, then it will be a blessing to them. We are praying today, God, show me how to take one day at a time. Brothers and sisters, we have members in our church or in our neighborhood that are going hungry. They don't have anything to eat. Some of them have rent arrears. They are almost being chased from their houses that they live in. Some of them are sick or going through a challenge. Brothers and sisters, this is the time for the church to intervene. The church has to pray for its members. And we have a system in our church. Every day, there is a member volunteering with devotion in the morning. You as a member, you need to join the church in the morning in prayer. When we pray together, these prayers helps a lot and sustains our church members. We have prayers on Wednesdays. We have prayers on Fridays. We have prayers on Saturdays. Don't just keep off from these prayers. Don't just think that is a WhatsApp group. No, this is the church in prayer. When we pray together these days, God answers us. Don't take it for granted, church members. Say amen and join yourself in these prayers, and God will see us through this uncertainty. The early church after the Pentecost, they were praying together. They would even eat together. If they realized there was someone who didn't have food, they would intervene. Some of them would sell land, bring the money to the church, and help each other. The church was united because it was praying together. Let us embrace this idea. When you hear elders call for prayers, join them and let us pray together as a church. When the church, early church, was praying, the king, Herod, decided to attack it. And we're going to read from Acts chapter 12, verse 1 downwards. Acts chapter 12, verse 1 downwards. The Bible says, and in those times, the king, Herod the king, stretched his arm to vex certain of the church members. He planned to attack church members. Verse 2, he got James and killed him, the brother of John, by the sword. He cut his head. Verse 3 then says that he saw this action pleased the Jews. Then he said, since it pleases the Jews, I will go for another one. And he went for Peter. He arrested him. He wanted to kill him, but it was a Passover period. So he put him in prison. The Bible says this, He put him in prison, and he knew there is a time Peter and John were in the prison, and the angel of God saved them, got them out of the prison. This time round, he didn't want to gamble. So he put him in prison, and he put 16 soldiers in charge of him, and two more tied on his right and left hand, so that he does not come out of the prison. The king, in his mind, whatever he's saying is, even God, if he wants this man released in the lockdown, he cannot come out. But listen now to what the church was doing. In Acts chapter 12, verse 5, let's see what the church was doing. Acts chapter 12, verse 5, and it says, but Peter therefore was kept in prison. Peter was kept in prison. Now listen to that sentence. But prayer was made without ceasing by the church unto God for Peter. These are specific prayers. Prayers are made by the church without ceasing to God for Peter. Very specific prayers. And this is why I'm telling you, members, when we join together in WhatsApp, when you send your request, you send your name, you have a prayer request, when we pray as a church, mentioning your name, like this church was mentioning the name of Peter, God will definitely intervene. We are not saying you tell us what you're suffering from. Just give your name and say, I have a silent prayer. When we pray, all of us, God will intervene. When they prayed, the angel of God went and released Peter. Hallelujah. He released Peter. He made sure he was safe. When he made sure that Peter was safe, Peter expected maybe to be told how to deal with Herod, because the king will then start looking for him. The angel never said anything. Maybe he expected to be given pocket money. The angel never said anything. He disappeared, like saying, one day at a time, Peter had to look for his way to where the church was. Brothers and sisters, I know we are in a lockdown, but the church can never be in a lockdown. When we pray, all of us, the church of God, we pray for our members, God intervenes. Hallelujah. One day at a time, let us pray. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we thank you for this day. Our prayer today, teach us to take a day after a time, instead of allowing us ourselves to be worried about the future. Father, allow us to come together as a church to pray for each other. Don't allow any member of our church to go without food or to be suffering when the church doesn't know. Give us that wisdom. Help us with your spirit to know who is in any issue for us to intervene. King of the glory, continue being with us and guiding us, for in Jesus' name we pray and believe.
Just a woman.
help me believe in what I could be and all that I am. Show me the stairway I hope to climb. Lord, for my sake, teach me to take one day at a time. One day at a time, sweet Jesus, that's all I'm asking from you. Just give me the strength to do every day what I have to do. Yesterday's gone, sweet Jesus, and tomorrow may never be mine. Lord, help me today, show me the way, one day at a time. Do you when you walked among men? Well, Jesus, you know, if you're looking below, it's worse now than then. Pushing and shouting, that's crowded my God. For my sake, teach me to take one day at a time. One day at a time, sweet Jesus, that's all I'm asking of you. Just give me the strength to do every day all I have to do. Yesterday's gone, sweet Jesus, and tomorrow may never be mine. Lord, help me today, show me the way, one day at a time. One day at a time, sweet Jesus, that's all I'm asking of you. Just give me the strength to do every day what I have to do. Yesterday's gone, sweet Jesus, and tomorrow may never be mine. Lord, help me today, show me the way, one day at a time. Lord, help me today, show me the way, one day at a time.